How did Jesus call you? Well, Paul continues, verse 6. Now it happened, as I journeyed and came near Damascus at about noon, suddenly a great light from heaven shone around me, and I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to me, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? So I answered, Who are you, Lord? And he said to me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. And those who were with me indeed saw the light and were afraid, but they did not hear the voice of him who spoke to me. So Paul connects the call of Jesus on his life with the relevance of what he just shared. In other words, hey, I persecuted these Christians. In fact, I was on my way to persecute these Christians some more when Jesus called me, when he reached out to me. Now, Paul's one of those guys who could pinpoint for you the exact day, the exact hour of the day when he was born again, couldn't he? And some of you maybe can do the same thing. Oh, I know when I was born again from the Lord. It happened just like this. But many of us cannot pinpoint a day. And that's okay. I know I cannot pinpoint a day. I don't know the moment I was saved. And that's all right. In Alcoholics Anonymous, 12-step groups, and before continuing the illustration, let me add this as an aside. There's something that bothers me when I hear, often from the pulpit, people just throwing little grenades against Alcoholics Anonymous, because there's something very inconsistent to me about celebrating the freedom of religion we have in the First Amendment of the Bill of Rights, and then blasting freedom of religion in a recovery group that for 80 years has helped millions of people. That just doesn't make sense to me. There's nothing in Alcoholics Anonymous that undermines the Christian faith. The two founders of Alcoholics Anonymous back during the time of the Great Depression were both Christians who read the Bible and prayed to Jesus for the strength to stay sober one day at a time. That's its origins. That's its roots. So a little ignorance can be damaging. Now, having said that, when you look at the 12 steps, the first one is basically to recognize that you're powerless over whatever it is, alcohol, crystal meth, gambling, and your life is screwed up. It's unmanageable. Then the second step speaks of coming to believe that there's someone out there more powerful than you. You're not God. You're not the God of this universe. And of course, step three is committing your life to God, whether it be Jesus Christ or, again, freedom of religion, God as you understand him. That coming to believe, I think, applies to a lot of Christians. See, now, I can tell you the day that I got baptized, for example, in water. Pirates Cove, Corona del Mar, in the ocean, Pastor Chuck Smith, I remember the day. But I was a Christian before that day. I was a Christian before I got baptized. Going back a little further, I can remember the day, Monday night, Greg Laurie, Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, and walking forward and making a public profession at an altar call so I could profess Jesus before man. I remember that. But I was a Christian before that, too. And I remember going to church that night with the intention, as soon as the altar call comes, I'm coming forward. That's why I was there, because I wanted to do it. I was already a believer, though. And I even remember going further back, sitting in my office by myself, reading a Christian book written by Bill Bright, founder of Campus Crusade, where he wrote, everyone needs to personally ask Jesus to forgive them and to be their Savior and all. I said, oh, you know, I've never done that. I ought to do that. But I was a Christian even before then, because I believed the gospel. I believed that Jesus, the Son of God, who died for my sins and rose from the dead. I believed that. For me, personally, I believed it. And so I came to believe, I don't know when, but I believed all the same. And I think, again, that that's true for a lot of us. Now, one thing I can tell you, even though I can't pinpoint a day, I know it was all around the spring of 1993. Now, I think we should be able to look at a time, you know, I don't know the day, but I know, man, it was the summer of 2002, or it was the fall of 1968, or whatever. It was that time when I got born again. I know that. That's when Jesus called me, and that was when it took place. I recognize that. We should have that in our lives. Our salvation is by God's grace. It is a free gift through faith, belief that Jesus died for our sins and rose from the dead. But nevertheless, belief in the gospel is not just head knowledge, is it? Oh yeah, I believe Jesus died on the cross for our sins, rose from the dead, Son of God. Yeah, yeah, yeah. See, a lot of people know the gospel. Head knowledge. Think about some university professor teaches religious studies or something, says, well, here's what Christians believe, that Jesus is the Son of God who died. And they'll go tell you what Muslims believe and what Buddhists believe and Hindus believe. Or to put it in a biblical example, James said, hey, you believe in one God? The demons also believe. They tremble. They're in fear and awe of the thought. And put another way, how are you any better than the demons when you just say, oh yeah, I believe in God? And that's why James goes on to talk about how our works evidence our saving faith. Not that our works save us, but our works show that we in fact do have saving faith. Because we must respond to the call. And so now Paul shows us his response to the call. Verse 10, so I said, what shall I do, Lord? Now that is the response of a saved man. What shall I do, Lord? The Lord said to me, arise and go into Damascus, and there you will be told all things which are appointed for you to do. And since I could not see for the glory of that light, being led by the hand of those who were with me, I came into Damascus. And a certain Ananias, a devout man according to the law, having a good testimony with all the Jews who dwelt there, he came to me and he stood and said to me, brother Saul, receive your sight. And at that same hour I looked up at him. Then he said, the God of our fathers has chosen you that you should know his will and see the just one and hear the voice of his mouth. For you will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. And now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Interestingly, that Ananias, and you remember him in chapter 9, the guy who came and Paul got his sight back when he laid hands on him and all, he does not even appear in Paul's testimony before Agrippa in chapter 26. Doesn't even mention him. But here he has such a prominent place. Why? Because again, he's emphasizing the Jewishness here. Notice how he describes him? A devout man according to the law. A good testimony with all the Jews. When he spoke to me, he spoke about the God of our fathers. Well, now to a Jew, the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You know who they're talking about, right? So Paul's trying to get this across. This is a Jewish thing. And again, what shall I do, Lord? That response. But here's the thing, the response does not save you. Well, I responded to Jesus' call, that's why I'm saved. The response is the evidence that you have believed. Again, put another way, if you think you're a Christian and you never ask, what do you want me to do, Lord? You are very misguided. If he is not personal in your life, if you're not asking the Lord, Lord, do you want me to go to college or maybe try to get a job? Lord, do you want me to date this person? Lord, do you want me to move? The Lord is to direct our path. Paul showed that very clearly.